so exciting. We're at the Caledonian Hotel in Edinburgh, and I'm going upstairs to meet Sean Connery. And better still, he's going to come to my flat. And better still, we're going to sit and watch his movies and talk about them. Can you believe it? We're going to film it, and you're going to see it.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Hey, hello. Hiya.
Hi, how are you?
Lovely to see you.
You just
are, are you not ready yet?
Well,
do you want us to give you a few minutes?
Well, yeah, I've just put this on.
All right, it looks good. We'll give you a few minutes and then, could we just come and have a wee quick look at your view and then we'll cut and then we'll get into the car. Come in, look at this. Thanks for coming all this way from Spain, Sean, that's very nice of you. Look at this view. When Scotland becomes independent and you become the King of Scotland, this will be your court.
Yeah, that's where they'll bury me, just over there.
Sean, so we are driving along in the heart of Edinburgh, right? What would happen if we stopped the car and you walked along the street? How would people react to you?
Well, it would turn out I'd probably know half of them. But they'd all be old age pensioners.
Do you ever feel that you've lost something by becoming a superstar and that you cannot... It's been 35 years since you could just slip across through this city. Now there's a woman there just looking at you in your car and her eyes are popping in her head.
Well, to slip through the city, when I used to slip through before, it was often accompanied with a kick in the arse by having to jump the railings because there was times when you're allowed in the park and times you weren't allowed. And we used to love getting in when you were not supposed to be there.
Way back in the 60s, you made a documentary, one of the few times you've directed called The Buller and the Bonnet. Yeah. And that was in some way about Scotland, wasn't it? Tell me about that.
The idea was to break down the barrier between labour and management. And it was a way, way ahead of its time in the toughest place.
It was a fight to the death. And this is the death. Harland and Wolfe, one of the proud names in Clyde Shipbuilding, is a graveyard. And there are others. Henderson, Simon Lovnitz, Blythewood, Hamilton, Ingalls, Denny's of Dumbarton. These shipyards have gone under with millions of pounds worth of orders and with some of the best workers in the world. There are some things you can't cure with deflation.
And there's one scene, I don't know if you remember, but there's one scene in The Buller and the Bonnet where you look through a pane of glass and you look out onto an empty factory floor and you can see, you must have done a dissolve through because you can see the ghosts of people playing
soccer.
Football. Do you remember that scene?
Yes, I like that.
What's that scene about, do you think? What were you trying to say there with those dissolves and things?
Well, we said it actually in the narration. I said, you just have to find a space and a ball, or you make up a ball, and before you know it, you are just all kicking it about. Mm-hmm. And that was my whole childhood, and what I, had aspirations to, such as they were, was soccer.
Yes.
And we used to play in the meadows here in the summer all day and run home for a piece to have something to eat and then run back and play. I think that's where one... the crowd of us then had got a certain kind of stamina
from. And you're actually in that scene, aren't you? You can see you halfway through running through.
That's right.
Is it sort of longing for those old days almost?
Well, there was also a sign up, football not allowed, which we shot.
Oh, yes. You played a lot of football. You were actually asked by Matt Busby to join the Man United team?
Yeah, well, Matt Busby offered me, I was 23 then, I think. We were in South Pacific in Manchester, an American actor in the cast. Robert Henderson said, "But wouldn't you want to be an actor?" And I seriously never even considered becoming an actor. And he said, "Well, by the time you're 25, if you haven't done anything, you're suddenly over the hill."
In football?
Yeah. He said, "But as an actor, you can go on."
So that's why, because you thought it's a better career move, anyway?
Well, I said, "Well, what would I do?" I mean, I'd never thought of it. And he said, "Well, you have to be a bit of a contradiction," he said, "to what you are." He said, "You have to be able to look as though you could work in a mine and have read Proust."
Uh-huh. And
he gave me a whole list of all the stuff to do. I said, "Okay," so I went to work with it.
And you did, actually? You read Proust, you read Stanislavski?
Well, I know Stanislavski, My Life in Art, an Actor Prepares. I read Tolstoy's War and Peace, Joyce's Finnegan's Wake.
God, what did you make of that? It's impossible.
No, I loved a lot of it because it's marvelous language and things, because the most erudite scholars have the same problems.
Yes.
With, you know, Lord Alfred Tennyson, Wimbledon, or the stuff that used to find you laughing.
Yes, yes.
And I read all Shakespeare, read all Shaw, Ibsen's plays, Remembrance of Things Past, which is, you know, this 12, Swan's Way, and all that.
Now, talking about books, your character in The Rock has spent all his time in prison reading books. Your character in Indiana Jones is an incredibly bookish man. He's lived all his life.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Is that a coincidence?
Well, one introduced these elements into the script, too.
You did?
Oh, yeah, I think so.
I suddenly remembered my Charlemagne. Let my armies be the rocks and the trees and the birds in the sky.
Here we are, Sean.
Sorry, you can't come in.
Sean, how often do you do this? Sit on a Saturday afternoon and watch your own movies?
Rarely.
We're going to watch films from throughout your career. A real work of art here. Let's have a look.
That's Janet, actually. Janet. Poor girl, she's gone. No Albert, no Albert can match the likes of him. Old Albert. My smile and I'm the guy. I'm the Irish girl. Wow. I can't tell you how long ago that was, actually, but I remember that I had so little experience about singing that it was a nightmare to learn it and to go and make the record, but to do it before we started the movie. And Janet and I went down, a guy called Tamaretti or Tamamuri or something was a conductor, and there was this great big orchestra, 50 piece or whatever it was, in the valley. And I was at one pedestal and she was at the other, and we had to. And suddenly, it was me to sing, and nothing came out. And they all stopped, and so after a few stops and starts, they realised that I had absolutely no experience of it, and therefore they would have to just take a recording, and I would do it against the recording. And then the nightmare came when they said, "Now we do the other side of the record," which was a song called "The Bally McQuilty Band," which I had to learn there and then and sing. So. With the help of some vodka with Janet and I, we did it.
Oh, she is my dear, my darling one. Her eyes so sparkling, full of fun. No other can match the likes of her. She is my dear, my darling one. My smiling and beguiling one. I love the ground she walks upon. My darling Irish girl.
I called you when your food was ready, but you were making so much noise you couldn't hear me.
Faith, I know I can't sing a lick, but when I'm roaring like Doran's bull, it works up a killing hunger in me.
And this was your first time filming in America.
Yeah.
And it was also your first hit film, really, wasn't it? It was the first that brought a decent box office.
Yeah. In fact, that was my first trip to America. Yes. First movie was Davio Gill, and in fact, I flew to go to... I didn't realise that on the plane all the food and drink was free. It took me for ages to order something.
And this film was produced by Walt Disney. Did you meet Walt Disney?
Oh, yeah. When we had the premiere, I went to the races with Walt in Ireland.
This film was shot by a guy called Wynton Hotch, and he went on to shoot one of the most beautiful films ever made, The Searchers. Do you remember that, John Wayne?
That's right, John Wayne,
now,
yeah.
Any recollections of Hotch?
Well, I wasn't so... conscious then of the technical aspect of shooting a movie.
Yes.
But Stevenson, who directed it and had co-written it, was a direct descendant of Robert Louis Stevenson. Yes. the cameraman I knew was exceptional because of the effects that they had created with all the calculations by him. And I thought that, with a very limited, experienced eye, that he had, it was very kind of rich lighting and without being kind of chocolate boxy.
Yes, absolutely, that's right.
Very good.
Yes. 3 years after this, something happened. You became a superstar.
Sounds like this is your life.
You became James Bond 007. Or as the Italians called you, Mr. Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Bang Bang.
Which is great, isn't it?
Yeah.
How early did you realise what size a phenomenon Bond would be?
I had no idea, as I'd never been there before, but it was the same in probably the ensuing 20 years,
yes.
Because I had no awareness of that scale of kind of reverence and pressure and what have you. It was around the same time as the Beatles.
Yes.
And the difference, of course, was that they had four of them to kick it around and blame each other. But I made as many mistakes as anybody in dealing with the situation because I never had a press representative or anything, and I found it a bit of a nightmare actually to deal with then, and eventually evolved to deal with it and handle it my own way.
Right. Okay, let's look at a clip from the first Bond movie, Dr. No.
Oh, with Ursula.
It's a dream sequence, isn't it?
She still is beautiful, actually.
Yeah?
Ursula, yeah. I still see her when I go to Rome. She's a great girl.
Underneath the mango.
Underneath the mango tree, my honey and me.
Who is that?
I didn't retire on the royalties of the record.
No, indeed not. What were you looking at in your shot? Were you actually looking at her when you were doing this?
Yes, I remember. In fact, you know, Dr. No was a very, very kind of poverty-stricken production, yes, in terms of finance.
$1 million.
It was less than that because the dollar was devalued before we started. Huh. And so it was, and it, in fact, it came in under. But I mean, that very sequence there, I remember Harry Saltzman and Cubby Broccoli were even out with spades when we were trying to make the beach, taking the sand back a bit. We didn't have the kind of equipment you could fly in, yes, and out there. And we were hand moving the sand. Wow. That's how much money we had. Wow.
Now tell me, what did filmmakers do to you, and what did you do to yourself to turn you into Bond? First of all, let's talk about visual things.
Well, I think that the most important element in the whole Bond series was, apart from Fleming himself, who, you know, written the original stuff and everything, I think it was Terence Young. I think he was the greatest influence.
The director of this picture?
Yeah, the director. Terence had really identified very much with being the Grand Seigneur, the elegant backgammon, tumbling asser. I mean, he took me on the trip to get our clothes and everything, and it was an eye-opener. The budget on the clothes was astronomical in relation to the film, but he was right, Terence, because there was a look about it, and we had shoes handmade at Lobbs, and no cufflinks, a special fold-back button, and I used a Windsor knot, very small Windsor knot. And equally, that we shared a kind of similar sense of humour about what was funny and what wasn't.
Oh!
Hello.
Aren't you in the wrong room, Mr. Bond?
Not from where I'm standing.
Since you're here, would you mind giving me something to put on?
Strangely enough, there's a lack of humour, actually, in Fleming's writing, because he was quite about that, but very, very, very bright, very erudite, and a real snob.
Yeah. And he introduced you to Noel Coward, is that right?
Yeah, well, Noel was living on the island then too, Jamaica. In fact, it's the only time I've ever been. I never got back again. Mm. And Noel was asked to play Dr. No, and he was quite funny about it because I became very friendly with Noel too.
Did you learn from him sort of eloquent mannerisms?
No, I think Terence was more the influence in that than anybody, you know, knowing what we're going for, and without going over the top, they one wanted to keep a real sense of reality about the threat of it all, the sexuality, the jokes, and the physicality, you know, when you're dealing out whatever it was.
I think you got the point.
It was coming in the wake of the kind of kitchen sink drama. So you wanted to have something that was still backgammon and chemin de fer and good food and beautiful girls and marvelous cars and rather luxurious locations.
Tell me, Miss Strange, do you play any other games? I mean, besides chemin de fer.
He was popular with men and women, which is kind of unusual. But anybody who, as I keep repeating, says that they knew it was going to be one of these immeasurable successes is... Lying.
Yeah. One of the things that I feel is that Bond was successful because he was free. He was free to travel the world. The only authority figure in his life was M. Apart from that, he was totally without authority. He was licensed to indulge his senses.
Yes, well, that's true too. And then, of course, he had the other side where he would do his diligence, you know, with the running and getting in fit and yogurt, not smoke so many cigarettes. Yes. And I feel my, if there is a criticism about where it's gone or come, is to too politically correct and a little too, not quite dirty enough, not quite sort of rough enough.
Do you mean the Judi Dench bit in Goldeneye where she says, Bond, you're a sexist, misogynist dinosaur? Is that what you mean?
Well, as a bit of that, I think that's what's kind of missing, because it gives a little bit of spice at no cost.
Yes.
And they start to drift towards a sort of antiseptic essence.
Yes. And then Bond escalated beyond your belief, and you changed your contract. Initially, your contract with Broccoli and Saltzman was that you could do non-Bond films, but they had to be with them.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Why did you change that?
Well, because, a few reasons, apart from their greed, was the problem of trying to accommodate another movie.
Yes.
You know, if you have a film with a very tight budget and you're doing a Bond film and it's going to run over, they have you on first call. And the problem was that they always took so long, and they always ran over, and there were major problems always in the way in trying to get a start date and a finish date.
Yes.
And consequently, you missed a lot of movies because you could never give a first call.
Now, one of the first non-Bond movies you did with Gina Lollobrigida, The Woman of Straw.
Woman of Straw, yeah.
And you didn't get on so well with Lollobrigida.
Oh, that was just really because she was very much a kind of diva then.
Yes.
She was a bit upset at me because I was doing films back to back, and I couldn't get to her to meet her until we met on the first day, because I finished on the Friday night shooting a movie and looping another one.
Yes.
But she was not too understanding and got off to the bad start, and then we got it sorted out. She was really a little over demanding.
And then you got the call from Mr. Hitchcock to make Marnie.
Yeah.
Now, from what I've read, most people accepted Hitchcock roles without having read the script. Is that the case? Yeah. And how was it different for you?
Well, because I was very curious as to what it was, because at the time of offering to me, Grace Kelly was supposed to be playing the other part.
Uh-huh.
And
the tippy head.
And yes, and so I said, well, I would, you know, certainly like to read it. Not unusual, I thought, because I would equally say I don't think I'm right for it, or this is more American than I could ever be.
Yes.
And but I liked it, and eventually I had a terrific time with him.
Were you worried that it was a controversial part because he's very sexually aggressive? There's a rape scene that we're about to watch.
Oh, no, not at all. I mean, I don't think I was that concerned about these kind of issues at all. And his preparation for movie making was second to none in terms of what he wanted in the script, and he had visualized and everything, and I enjoyed enormously working with him.
Tell us very briefly the storyline of the film so we can understand what's happening here.
Well, it's a girl who's, from what I remember, I'm not very good in the past there. Proust's okay, I'm not. She was a girl who had a terrible time, and her mother had been a hooker. And I played a very wealthy Boston type. She comes as a secretary and then steals the money.
Yes.
And then I go
and
after
you're
her.
Erotic, you're sexually attracted because she steals the money.
Well, a combination of quite a few things.
Yeah. Okay, let's have a look at the scene.
If you don't mind, I'd like to go to bed. I've told you the light from the sitting room bothers me.
Well, we certainly can't have anything bothering you, can we?
This is the night of supposed consummation when it was our honeymoon.
Yes.
You don't want to go to bed. Please get out.
But I do want to go to bed, Marnie. I very much want to go to bed.
No!
I'm sorry, Marnie.
Smoke coming at the end of a tunnel.
Oh, yes. Enough. But look at there. I mean, they've really shaved your eyebrows there, haven't they?
Well, yeah, they did everything in my first kind of introduction to the kind of perfecto, as it were, of the Hollywood. I think they really wanted somebody like Cary Grant, or Cary Grant, whatever it is. And then, same as with the hairline had to be perfect with the piece, and and then the guy had a special way of doing your eyebrows and
plucking.
Yes, he did everything, and the line, and then there would never had could be a sort of suggestion of a like everybody now with the stubble look, you know, which is. Let me ask you a question. I see that everybody still walks around, these young people, with their shirt hanging out. What does it mean? It's so uncomfortable. That's how they get a chill in the kidneys. Anyway, that was sort of the mode for Hollywood then, and Hitch was very much... And, you know, he had a saying, he always said, whatever your question got a little too involved. I never had too many problems in discussing anything with him. He would just say, oh, it's just a movie. You know, no matter what, and he, in that movie, had some major problems because he was producing and directing, and the blue screen stuff was not working, and we had to do it three times, and he had quite a lot of flack from stuff that was not going well, and the woman who wrote the film,
J. Preston Allen,
marvelously dynamic. Told me, I always remember that when she was young, she was so kind of electric with herself that she used to put cotton wool between her toes, which must tell you something. And she came and was sort of watching
and rather put, I think, Tippy off quite a bit. But in spite of it all, it came out in a funny way. It had one of these kind of retarded later recognition for being a certain kind of movie.
Absolutely. You didn't make many so-called women's movies about women's psychological characters. Most of your films are about men, men's worlds.
Yeah, that's true. I'm not quite sure how one would answer that. I'm not, I think, particularly skilled in understanding women. I don't know how many men are, but and I think I find, and it's more often than not the case that most of the moment the woman is in any way attracted, then it has a sexual connotation, which I suppose. And when you have, I find lots of men attractive, I like them, and my preference is really for the company of men. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But I don't have any sexual attractions to them, I don't think, mm-hmm. at the moment.
And in fact, in quite a few of your films, homosexuality is quite a threat, isn't it? When you think about it, In the Hill, and even in The Rock, when you come out of thing, you say, I've avoided, keep my arse to the wall, or something like that. Why is that just because that's the way men's worlds are, do you think? You've never played a gay character, for example?
No, I've not, and I wouldn't have any problem. I played Alexander the Great.
Yes, well, that's true, yes.
But Michael Caine did the Neil Simon movie with Maggie Smith. What was it called? California Suite.
California Suite, yeah.
And he played the gay guy with her. And had I been offered it, I would have played it.
I could have seen you, I think you would have been very good in Kiss of the Spider Woman, in William Hurt's part.
Oh, really?
Anyway, was that really?
Well, okay.
Let's move on to one of these archetypal men's world films. This is a film with no martinis, no girls, no foreign locations. It's The Hill.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Voila! Come here! Right foot! On your feet, lads! Come on! You, douse it!
Really, one of your best films?
Yeah, I agree. Well, it's one of the few genuine ensemble movies.
On your feet, lad, double! On your feet and double! Douse it!
Stop, he's crazy!
I said douse him!
I must say, when I first met Sidney, who is a dear friend.
Sidney Lumet, the director, we did five films with him.
Yeah, and we have this long-lasting relationship and everything, and it's still a terrific charge, and I adore working with him.
Yeah.
But I couldn't honestly believe that an American would have such a grasp on the kind of idiosyncrasies of discipline in a British military establishment. Mm-hmm. Having been in the Navy myself, and knowing something about the military, and having been exposed to the American side of the Navy, which I was when I was at in Plymouth, Portsmouth, I couldn't quite see how he would get such a handle on it. And he did.
Tell me a wee bit about your character in the film. Describe it briefly.
Well, he's a sergeant who's in a given situation with some officers, and he's been given an order, a command, that is an absolute absurdity to carry this out. And he defies it. And of course, it's the principle. It's probably why I got invalided out of the Navy with ulcers. But there is no questioning. Otherwise, it doesn't work. A military force, naval, whatever, doesn't work unless the chain of command is absolute. So if somebody says something who is above you, you have to do it. Then you can contest it afterwards. Of course, when it's life or death, it's a bit difficult afterwards if you're all dead.
Yeah.
But that's why they make such decisive personnel.
Yes.
Well, this character had a problem with that and didn't do it, and then slogged the officer, and then ended up in Chokey, which is the prison where the whole film really takes place.
Okay, let's look at the character anyway.
What kind of a soldier are you?
I'm a live one, unless Williams has got other plans for me.
Discipline. The arm is run on discipline.
I'm a regular soldier because I couldn't get a bloody job in Civvy Street. But I was a good toy, clockwork soldier, just like you are. You threw an order at me and I could pick it up like a dog picks up a bone.
On your feet and you listen.
No, you listen. 3 bloody years in the desert, 3 bloody years fighting under paid gunmen, that's who we are.
Treason. You're talking treason.
Right.
Get on your feet.
Okay, Susan. That's para 531, section 7. Any person committing any traitorous or mutinous practice may be sentenced to penal servitude for the term of his natural life.
Are you crazy?
All right. All I know is that I can't do things that don't make sense to me anymore. You can still live by the book. But it's out of date, it's stupid and out of date.
Why have you played so many characters like him who are in some way obsessed by authority? You've played either authority figures or people who are challenging authority. Is this a theme that interests you?
No, I think I basically dislike intentionally injustice.
Yes.
And in a funny way, if you find the situation or circumstance, say in the military, unjust, then you have no place in the military. Because that's how it operates. Incidentally, that scene, I just remember, just looking at it now, I haven't thought about it for ages, but that scene was never in the movie. It was written by Sidney Lumet, felt that the Harry's part and my part needed a personal confrontation.
Uh-huh.
Because it suddenly put the two positions, because they were both of the same, they're both sergeants. Harry was in charge. You know, the basic prison, whipping out the punishment and everything. But to question it the way he does, which is very much what I would voice, and I had nothing to do with the rewrite.
Yes. That's very surprising to hear that, because this is why I put that clip on this reel, is because it tells you the theme of the film. This is the only scene in the film that really
absolutely
tells you
right, but we didn't realise that was missing in the shooting, and it was we're into third week of shooting in El Maria when Sidney came up with the idea of this. It's the essence of the piece.
It's the heart, isn't it?
Yeah.
Anyway, looking on at your career, you did Thunderball after this, another Bond movie. Then a film, Shalako, with Brigitte Bardot.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Which was an uneven film, really,
oh,
wasn't
yeah.
it?
Oh, yeah, well, that's very polite.
And then you decided to do one more Bond, Diamonds Are Forever. But you got a huge fee, over a million bucks for that. But
yeah,
that
They'd never paid that kind of money before then. Mm.
That was like the biggest fee ever, apparently, for a movie.
Yeah.
And that money went to your trust. Tell us briefly about your trust.
Yeah, here in Edinburgh. Yeah. SIET, Scottish International Education Trust.
And what's the aim of the trust?
Well, it's just education, again, for anybody, but the only deciding factor is they have to be Scottish, and it's for people in Scotland, and we put out anywhere between 65, 75, 85,000 pounds a year in grants.
How would you characterise the 1970s in your career? Is it fair to say it was an uneven time?
If I knew what you were talking about, yes.
The movies.
I can't remember dates like that.
Okay. Well, what was the biggest commercial disaster that you made? The worst box office?
The worst box office, considering how much it cost and everything, I suppose, was the Molly Maguires.
Really?
Yeah. Cost $10 million then, because they had to submerge everything in the streets. They put the lines down and just changed the whole place. It had been cheaper to come to Scotland or Ireland or Wales and shoot the mine there. Well, there was old mines and everything.
Yes.
The production cost a fortune.
The Offence, of course, was a great picture.
Oh, yeah, yeah. All my family went to see it.
But then you made Zardoz, which is the one...
Well,
with
that's
you and
also another one that has a strange kind of cult following.
It has. Yeah. You in a red nappy, is that right?
Yeah, and a ponytail.
And then you made The Man Who Would Be King.
Oh, yeah. That's a good movie.
I think one of your best.
We're going to teach you soldiering. The world's noblest profession. When we've done with you, you'll be able to stand up and slaughter your enemies like civilized men. But first, you'll have to learn to march in step. Do the manual of arms without even having to think. Good soldiers don't think. They just obey. Do you suppose if a man thought twice, he'd give his life for queen and country? Not bloody likely. He wouldn't go near the battlefield.
Why did you suddenly start becoming big box office again? What happened in the mid-80s? You got a new agent. Did that affect things?
No, otherwise you'd have filmed him.
Indeed. But I'm thinking of when you, at the time that you won your Oscar for The Untouchables.
Oh, well, yeah. Well, I did four movies for Paramount, I think.
Yes.
And they were all the same, had terrific box office. The Untouchables, Indiana Jones,
yes.
Red October.
Hunt for Red October.
And there was one other.
Highlander.
Oh, yes.
Tell me about your character in The Untouchables.
Jimmy Malone. He was, again, somebody who was so cynical about the whole Al Capone, what they were all trying to do, and nobody really understood how you were going to deal with such venom as the Capone regime.
Yes.
He understood how it would be done, but he wasn't in a position ever to do it. The graph, as it were, for him was a guy who suddenly got a chance very late, near retirement, to be a main feature player in turning it around. And so he got more and more up and up as the movie went on.
Yes. Let's watch it.
What do you want? I'd like to talk to you.
Come in.
What I need is a small group of men, handpicked, starting with you.
Nash, I am just a poor beat cop.
Now, how can I help you?
Just work with me.
But why should I, though?
Because you're a good cop. How do you know that?
You told me.
I'm such a good cop. How come I'm walking the beat then at my age?
What do you want to tell me?
Well, maybe I'm that whore with a heart of gold. Or the one good cop in the bad town. Well, is that what you want to hear?
I didn't ask you and I don't care. You want to stay on the beat? You do that. If you'd like to come with me, I need your help. I'm asking you for help.
Well, that's a thing you fear, isn't it? Mr. Ness, I wish I'd met you 10 years and 20 pounds ago. But I just think it got more important to me to stay alive. And that's why I'm walking the beat. Thank you, no.
Which of these two men do you think is the better man? The man who has sort of learned through life or the man who's sort of still fresh and naive?
Well, there's a combination of both in both.
Yeah.
You know, the point is this, that he's saying I wish 10 years ago because he didn't think where he's reached now that he'd be capable of doing the things that he does do eventually in the movie, which is the good writing of Mamet. Mm. And he comes in and he is naive and he does make the lead him up the path and then people have to get killed and everything. And then that meeting in the church kind of crystallizes what the real crossover is when he makes the pledge.
Yes. And which of those two men do you identify more with? You've said in several interviews that you like enthusiasts, mm-hmm. you know, and Cosner Ness is nothing if not that. He's
yeah.
like such a zealous... idealistic.
Well, that's true, but yeah, and that's why I liked Kevin's playing of it and everything, and I thought they were very unfair in the criticism of his performance in the movie. But you say, which person do I prefer of
yes.
the two?
Which of those two men could save the world most? Which quality do we need most? Do we need idealism or do we need experience?
No, you need experience.
Now tell me, what do you think is your greatest artistic failure? Which was the poorest quality film, would you say?
Well, funnily enough, a movie I adored was The Russia House.
Yes.
And it meandered a bit in the third act, as it were. But I liked the movie. I liked the whole John le Carré's story about what it was trying to do, about mm-hmm. coming out of that whole post-wall down, dealing with the Russians and everything. I thought it was... and I found it very moving, the whole story. And I thought, and Le Carre was very, very enthusiastic about it too, so I'm not alone, but it didn't do well at all.
Finally, Sean, let's come right up to the 1990s and your film, The Rock.
There are 81 hostages still up there.
Yeah, like me.
All right, you want to play tough? You want to play tough with me? Okay, FBI, freeze, sucker!
I'll fire.
No, you won't.
Throw down.
You're not short.
Let's find out.
I could. You know. Sergeant, safety's on.
Good speed. Have you resolved the situation?
Not yet.
Now, let me just stop it there a minute, Sean. Let me ask you about this. Compared to the Bond style, you know, where everything was so brightly lit and you had very wide angles and you had loads of space to move in, look at this here. You're in focus, but his hand's out of focus, the background's out of focus. That sort of long lens style, does that make it harder for you?
No, not at all, because it's rather like one of your observations in the notes when you were talking before was about the Sidney Lumet's technique of going very close and wide, and to play something is kind of contrary and violent and changing as the offense. If you are playing whatever it is, it should be able to hold with whatever lens. The lens shouldn't really matter.
But if you backed back 6 inches here, you'd be out of focus, wouldn't you?
Well, that's right, but it just means that you have to be more accurate in terms of markings and positions and relation. Yes. But that's mechanics as opposed to the creative side of acting, of how far you can go or whether you're doing too much or whatever. I don't think that's a problem, but some actors, maybe, I don't know. I hadn't thought of it until you mentioned it now, but it just means that you have to be more precise in terms of positioning.
And what about those Hitchcock close-ups? Is the same thing there? You can't move, you have to be incredibly
steady. That's right, yeah. But then it usually comes at a time when it's necessary to be in a very fixed position. Like, say, there, when he's pulling a gun on you, you're not going to sort of waft around because you're going to have to focus on him.
Yes.
And say, no, you won't.
Yes.
I would, you wouldn't.
What I'd like to ask you particularly is about how you feel about working with directors who have come through the video technology, who have worked in MTV and through advertising, of which the director of this picture was an example.
Yeah, well, Michael Bay did Bad Boys. I saw the movie.
Yes.
I didn't care for the movie. I could see there was a lot of sort of specifically American-type humor, which is nothing wrong with that. I mean, I'm talking about my personal choice. But then when I was presented with the possibility of making the movie with him, I looked at the film again. There was no question that he had an eye for going for opening and getting into scenes and a tremendous energy.
Why should I trust you now?
You've got my word.
What do you shake on it?
Freeze, mister!
Oh, man! Help!
Drop the gun, or I drop your boss.
One was obviously not mistaken at all, because when the film was first shown, all these qualities were exposed. The problems that accompanied it, of course, is his lack of experience in dealing with actors and understanding the rhythm of a two-hour movie. And where the breathing spaces in terms of actors come and where the character is expressed. And so the post-production was a great deal of trauma about that. And eventually we got it right. But,
and how did, at the writing stage, do you insist on more character in your writing in a film?
Yeah, well, I brought Ian Lefrenny and Dick Clements
in,
who I've known over 30 years now. Marvelous. Good ideas for writing.
You're right. I don't use guns and I don't kick down doors. This is what I do.
I haven't got my glasses.
What is it?
You exec produced this film as well?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Why do you exec produce?
Well, I've been doing it now for 20-odd years on the movies, and I took the physical position on the last half a dozen or so.
Yes.
So it doesn't, as I say, look like a nosy, busy actor, but an executive producer who's asking the questions. And because one of the problems, the major problem between in the making of the movies today, everybody's got a nightmare time because of the cost and escalation. I've been saying for 15 years now, the problem is that the gap between the people who green light and the people who execute the movie making is forever widening. Mm. And the last thing they will agree or acknowledge in Hollywood is, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. I've only got really one last question for you, and it is, why did you not accept the role of God in the new film by the Trainspotting team called A Life Less Ordinary? You would have played a good God, wouldn't you?
Well, I don't know. it would certainly be everybody's choice, but... no, I'm trying to think why. I was in the midst of too many things with Fountain Bridge at the moment, the practicalities of it.
Yes.
I mean, I spoke to them. I called them. I got them in Canada.
Oh, yes.
And McDonald I spoke to. And then I touched base with... Danny Boyle in London.
Yes.
And, Trainspotting, I think, is a movie that should be seen by everybody, especially in Edinburgh.
Yes. Tell me, Orson Welles said that some people are born to be king actors, and he thought he was born to be a king actor. Is there any type of role that you think you were born to play? I mean, you.
No, well, I don't have, you know, I don't have a problem with the... most stuff, really. I don't feel clear or out of place wearing either a monk's habit or a crown and period stuff, or what have you. And I think that if the actor doesn't have that uneasiness, then it's apparent. But the actors, like, I remember William Holden and Paul Newman had this real thing that they couldn't wear kind of period stuff because they didn't feel comfortable in it. But that's the only reason why they couldn't wear it.
Yes.
And if they could overcome that, I would think they'd have no problem wearing it.
Sean, it's you can come to my flat absolutely any time, and it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I like your place.
And the first film in our Connery collection is the Second World War military prison drama, and as you heard, one of Sean's favourites, The Hill, here on BBC Two in an hour. And next this evening, comedy at number 10 with Jim Hacker.